So skeletal muscle is your largest internal organ. It represents 1/3 to 1/2 of your body weight. If that organ doesn't function properly, you are guaranteed to be ill and you may be dead. Understanding how that organ works is important because at present, we have almost no treatments for muscle wasting or for muscle weakness. Nothing to preserve that organ. That's the reason that we have this center, and that's the reason we do the work we do.
We were in a unique situation in which we had a cluster of strong senior investigators in the field of muscle biology. We saw an opportunity to create a unique research strength that would set Kentucky apart from a lot of other research institutions across the country.
Researchers from 30 departments and 9 colleges have joined together to study muscle weakness through the Center for Muscle Biology at the University of Kentucky. Center investigators study weakness and dysfunction in skeletal and heart muscle, which applies to normal aging, and in chronic diseases like heart disease, cancer, obesity, diabetes, and rheumatoid arthritis.
In all of these conditions, muscle weakness is a problem that plagues many patients. If they have muscle weakness, they're much sicker than if they don't. And it can predispose people, it can set people up for premature death.
This is an important thing. We have some animal studies out there now because of the way we can go and genetically modify tissues in a very specific manner, where they have rescued aspects of muscle in an animal that has disease. Those animals live longer. With our focus on weakness and its contribution to chronic disease, morbidity, mortality, we are in a unique position to be a national leader in this area.
Center projects range from basic science to clinical studies to running clinics. On the basic science side, Charlotte Peterson's team is looking at satellite cells.
So satellite cells are actually the stem cells in muscle. Every adult organ has stem cells, which are really important for regeneration and maintenance of the tissue. And in muscle, they're the satellite cells, which is why your muscle is so plastic, as we call it, that it can grow enormously. You can damage it, it can regenerate itself, and this is because of these really robust stem cells that are present in the muscle. If you decide you do want to grow your muscles, do the stem cells actually participate in that? Because if they do, then they are a good therapeutic target. If, for example, in aging and your muscles are wasting, is a viable therapeutic approach to introduce stem cells or not? And we really don't know that right now. During the normal maintenance of muscle, during regrowth after atrophy, for example, bed rest or something, can the stem cells be mobilized to help with that process? Is that really one of their functions?
Utilizing UK's expertise in obesity and heart disease, Brandon Fornwalt is using imaging to reveal changes in heart muscle in children with obesity.
We had a pediatric obesity clinic here with over 800 kids with obesity. I realized that we had this brand new 7 Tesla $3 million MRI, which we could use to image mouse models of obesity, where we feed the mice a high-fat diet and we watch what happens to their heart over time, and they get big changes in their hearts. Their hearts start to thicken, they start to not contract as well. One of the things I'm doing now is using this new imaging technology to look at the function of the heart in mouse models of obesity, and then we're also doing the same imaging in the kids that are coming into the pediatric obesity clinic. Amazingly enough, by the ages of 9, 10 years old, you're already seeing changes in the heart in children, and we have no idea what the long-term complications of that are.
Athletic trainer Tim Butterfield's team is measuring the effects of massage on muscle by building devices and studying changes at the cellular level.
Well, I think it's important to measure scientifically because everybody wants a massage, and people spend a lot of money on massage, and people also spend a lot of money on pharmacological interventions when people have pain. And if there's something that will help muscle adapt and heal and become better at performing its function, if less expensive and easier to apply, then I think it's worth investigating.
It allows us the opportunity to not only just look at how much force we're applying to the muscle, but it also allows us to even evaluate that. You know, what type of a force is too much? What's too little? What's the optimal force to be applied to get the response that we're looking for?
So if we can control all those variables and then pull out the cells and see how they respond, we have a better idea of what caused that cell to respond that way.
If we know the mechanism underlying what is happening at the cellular level, we can better tailor our treatments.
Physical therapist Brian Noren's team is improving rehab for athletes recovering from knee surgery to repair torn ligaments by creating 3D models.
One of the big implications, unfortunately, of having ACL reconstructions is that within 10 to 15 years, those individuals will go on to, at least 75% of them will go on to develop osteoarthritis. So if you can imagine, if you tear your ACL at the age of 20, by the age of 35, you might have the knee of somebody who is, for example, is 65 years old. And that has a number of long-term health implications. So we put these little retroreflective markers on their various locations throughout their legs, and ultimately what we're able to do is to build a three-dimensional representation of that individual. And then we've written our own computer code to be able to extract data from that. But you can come in and just to have your running form or your walking form evaluated, and we can give you feedback on how you're doing. So we'll compare your mechanics to somebody who's healthy, never had any problems. We spend twice as much time after the data collection talking with you about what we saw, steps you can take to maybe make some changes, and potentially avoid having an injury at a later date.
Being able to have physiologists and molecular biologists, engineers, athletic trainers, physical therapists, all working together to try to understand and improve the quality of life for people is really quite a unique situation.
I find that innovation really comes at the crossroads of disciplines. So, you know, with my background in physical therapy and biomechanics, and I have an interest in muscle, to be able to go to the center and talk with somebody who is an expert in their particular domain of research, for example, Charlotte Peterson and her work in satellite cells and muscle, and to be able to find those areas of overlap, I think leads to really interesting research projects and helps us innovate and solve problems that if I were just doing my thing over and over and over again, we would really never be able to get to.
What our center does is it allows people who are interested in various diseases to talk to each other, to share techniques, to share information, to share biological insights, but we'll think more creatively about how to approach a problem.
So if I'm a basic scientist, I generally don't interact with clinicians, and if I'm a clinician, I don't have time to interact with the basic scientists. But if we're talking together and we have a shared vision and mission, then we can actually move the discoveries from the bench to the clinic much faster.